So I'm going to talk about the integral role of design in a disruptive business. And I'll draw mostly from work that I've done over the last 10 years, particularly where I was CEO of the UK Design Council. And there we were working with high-tech ventures, small manufacturing companies, as well as doing innovation at scale with partners like the NHS. I'm going to explore some disruptive ventures. So as the Danes would say, expect a sort of smorgasbord of actual design. I'm going to set out a framework to look at where the sort of common features or qualities are. And then I've got six key questions to look at where design fits in. So what are the features? What are the qualities of a disruptive business? Well, we've heard a number of them yesterday. I find a really good database is the MIT database. Have you come across that? If you haven't, I think it's really worth a visit. It's really interactive, really interesting. And I think they get beyond the point at which you're looking at just an interesting piece of technology or a new idea, but actually to companies that innovate and carry on innovating and do new things on an ongoing basis. You know, unsurprisingly, there are quite a lot of familiar names in there. All of them have done something very special in the recent period. Novartis, who've genetically engineered a new way to create vaccines for flu viruses. Audi, who now have in Silicon Valley a self-parking car park where your Audi will park itself and come and return to you. So, I mean, these are all companies that are doing something disruptive. And the question is, what are the qualities that they have in common? And I look here, we were talking about empathy. Design, of course, yes, it's about problem solving, we've heard, but design always is about an emotional response. A very good friend of mine, Richard Seymour, product designer, talks about the fact that design is more than ergonomics. It's about emotional ergonomics. So I look for the emotional words that connect these businesses up, like love and power and respect. Well, let me just elaborate on that a little bit. So our businesses are loved or not based on their identity, on who they are. And that gets expressed, of course, through our brand, through all the touch points with our consumers, but as well through our culture internally. It gets felt, it's how we live as a business. We gain power, in fact, we're given power by our consumers, by our stakeholders, our investors, because of our significance, our relevance in the world. I mean, if we're Novartis and we've come up with a new way of genetically engineering vaccines, that's relevant, that's significant. And of course, that's delivering a legacy out there. And internally, it's all about what we will do in the future. Sir George Fisternick told me that when he set up this place, Villa Maria, he had a 50-year business plan. I've never heard of that before. A 50-year business plan actually worked out. That's prophecy. And respect. We gain respect based on our competence, based on the fact that on a daily basis, we can deliver good products and services, quality products and services, day in, day out. And of course, internally, what we all look for from our colleagues is our organizing capacity, our ability to make all of this stuff happen. So love, power, and respect. So I see these three as unifying features with design at the center. And I'm going to ask these six questions, which I hope will illuminate this a little further. So let's start with love. I actually really love this picture. This is the first customer of the iPhone 5 leaping out of the Covent Garden Apple store. And the thing, I suppose, that I really look for is not just his face, it's the face of the people who work in the Apple store. And, you know, it's not acting. So the question is, and we've heard a little bit about this whole issue of co-creation, is are you a co-creator? And perhaps this wouldn't have been quite so relevant 10 years ago. It certainly is today in an internet-enabled world, as we've been hearing, in an omni-channel world. And so let me introduce you, if you don't know them, some of these stories you may know. We live in, as we said, in an internet-connected world. You may be getting these on your Twitter feeds. But these are some guys that I know, and I recently interviewed Chloe McIntosh, the designer and creative director. These are all the founders of the company. And actually, there's a story there about how that business is formed at the heart, which has so many of the right components to make it a disruptive business. But very importantly, Chloe McIntosh, a designer, architect, ex-Fosters, educated at the École des Beaux-Arts in Paris, is a founder and creative director. She exerts a huge amount of influence on what that business is all about. Design and design thinking is right at the heart of a disruptive company. And the concept is fairly simple. It's let's create really well-designed, added-value furniture and sell it direct from the web to the consumer, and we will manufacture it wherever is most effective in the world, often, in this case, in China. But they are doing some really clever stuff in terms of the way that they relate to their customers. Now, they are an internet business, but they do actually have a place that you can go and visit. It's like sort of showroom type experience, but unlike most that you've experienced, and they're really pushing out the boat, they are doing some disruptive things here, and they're constantly trying to understand how to evolve that. So you go in there and they've got little 3D printed versions of all of their products and swatches, and what they're already finding is that the people who visit, 1 in 4 click and buy. But as I said, these guys, they set out actually with the idea of co-creation. I remember Brent Hoberman talking to me about that 3 years ago when they set the business up. And the sofa on the right is a recent example. So they set a competition to ask designers who'd like to design a sofa for us. And then they cast out to their customers. They got 10,000 people voting online to determine what the product should be. And then they had the faith to say, okay, you decided it's this, the Lovebird sofa, we'll find where best to manufacture it. They did in Italy, and that's now part of their range. I mean, that is both, what they're doing there is both creation, curation, and co-creation. But co-creation, these guys are masters already at how to manage this within their business. And that is absolutely, in a really short period of time, making them loved by their consumers. And it's showing in their results. So, I mean, a company that started from zero 3 years ago, they're already turning over in the tens of millions, and they're establishing themselves in new territories. And here's another example. This is a company that we were involved in, actually, significantly, when I was at the Design Council. Better by Design has its own program of coaching, and this is one of the companies that went through the Design Council's coaching program, and indeed, the coach that worked on this is a non-executive director of the company now. Sugru is a silicon. It's adhesive, and also it hardens overnight. And basically, the idea is that you can hack products. You can reform them. You can amend them. You can turn them into whatever you want them to be. It's very, very clever. But of course, one of the issues for a very young company without big advertising budgets is how do I get the idea of what my business is all about across to my consumers so that I can grow it? I'm really convinced that this is something really useful. So what they opted to do was co-create their own marketing. It was very, very clever. So what they did is they started to make films of how you could use this product, Sugru. And they asked their consumers to do the same and join them in a movement. I'll just show you one of the films. So they've become part of this whole making revolution, and actually they've become an instigator and a key player in that. And there's a brilliant website which I'd really recommend called Fixperts, and they've been also part of now what has become a movement about how you can mend, how you can remake things. So both of these guys, I think, are brilliant at co-creating, and that co-creating makes them loved by their consumers. But the other, and we've heard a little bit about storytelling, and actually, I read an article on the Harvard Business Review where they talk about story doing, because, of course, it isn't just about how you story tell, it's about how you convert your stories into real action. And design, of course, is key to that. Now, I want to give you one example. The example that actually I'm going to give is not one of mine. It's one that I picked up recently when I was over in Denmark. I was speaking at the Index Awards. Again, I'd recommend them really highly. It's all about design to improve life. It's a sort of European Nobel Prize for design. A lot of amazing examples of design thinking. And I heard Kavita Shukla explain what she's done, a new idea, an entrepreneur who recently won the Kauffman Foundation Awards, which is the single biggest award for an entrepreneur in the States. And I think she's not just a master of storytelling, which has helped her get her unique idea, a very disruptive idea, as you'll hear, off the ground, but she is very much a story doer, and she has done that via design. I'll just show you, I think it's better to hear it from her.
Fresh paper is just a simple little 5-inch by 5-inch sheet of paper. It's infused with organic spices that are naturally antifungal and antibacterial. So if you just put one little sheet of fresh paper in any box or carton filled with produce, it would keep everything in there fresh for 2 to 4 times longer. My name is Kavita Shukla. I'm the founder and inventor of Fenugreen Fresh Paper. I first got the idea for fresh paper when I was visiting my grandma in India, and I accidentally drank some tap water. And in India, you're really not supposed to drink the water. And my grandma went in her kitchen and she made this mixture of different herbs and spices, and she said, oh, just drink this. So I drank it and I didn't get sick. And then I became really curious about the different herbs and spices that she'd used. And over the years, I actually ended up finding that some of the spices in the mixture were able to inhibit the growth of common bacteria and fungus that I found kind of around my kitchen. And eventually, I created fresh paper. I was shocked to find out that over 1.6 billion people still live without access to basic refrigeration. And the Whole Foods partnership actually helped us launch our Buy a Pack, Give a Pack program, where for every single pack that we sell, we actually donate one to a local food bank.
So an amazing storyteller, but she has used, I mean, she's not only, I think, a great design thinker, but she's used design and translated what she's doing into every aspect of the product, all of the touch points. The website, you can see actually, I mean, you can just about see here that it's got the sort of Czech tablecloth on the website. It's quite folksy, and that you can see the whole way in which her ideas are now embedded into all of the communication material, the brand, the way that they present themselves as a company to the consumer. You feel immediately that you're part of this mission. Kavita has got a mission to change the world, and you're part of it when you become one of her customers. It's very clever, and it's really taking off, and she's built that ground up, starting in the markets in Manhattan. So, this first theme of love, drawn from identity, and I think the two questions are you a co-creator, and does design tell your story? So I want to move on to this issue of power that we draw from our significance, our relevance in the world. And the question here is, do you design the future? And in my view, and what I see working in so many businesses, is that you need different sorts of design skills often to draw these sort of issues out in your business. And to illustrate this, I want to introduce you to Daisy. Now, some of you may have come across Daisy Ginsberg, but I think that she represents to me what designers, and she is a designer, can do working with entrepreneurs and technologists to envision what the possibilities might be, but to do more than that, to go one step further and actually be there to prompt debate. And design is absolutely a practical tool, and a practical tool for what is possible, but it's also a practical tool that can help us decide what we want to do, the scenarios, and help us make choices. And I think Daisy has been doing this brilliantly with the science community, and particularly geneticists. So the particular story, I'm just going to pick on one of her stories. I think it's very clever, but I think it illustrates the point. It's called E-Chromi, and she was working with a group of scientists at Cambridge University. What they'd done is they'd had a discovery around a genetically engineered bacteria that excretes, in certain conditions, pigments. So visual pigments that you can pick up by the naked eye. So what she did was she put together a product timeline looking at what you could anticipate might come from such a discovery, what sort of products when could arrive into the market, and then opened up a discussion about would we want those things and what are the ethics around them, so that you could begin to anticipate what the real issues would be in the wider world. So this is just one example. So the E-Chromi could be part of a probiotic yogurt. It could then colonize the gut, and that would keep a watch out for the chemical markers of disease. So for instance, if a disease is detected, whether that's worms or colorectal cancer, then literally, you'd shit out your results. But there's a serious point. And that, you've probably seen this. This is the cortex. We train our designers to do this. But too often, businesses don't take advantage of this unique skill. Here's a young designer, just graduated from New Zealand, and has got a Dyson Award. And I met Jake Evel. He came to see me when I was in London, and I was really impressed. But it's exactly doing the same thing as Daisy does, which is create a vision of what might be possible. In this case, Jake's looked at what one of the possibilities around 3D printing, and he said, hey, look, what we could do is we could create new lightweight casts. And in fact, the mesh of the cast could be denser or looser, defined by a computer program, so that then, you know, we can define how much mobility or not we want in that particular joint. Very, very clever. Exactly what designers do. So the question is, are we using those sort of designers and are we incorporating those skills into our business? Because that really will help with our significance in the marketplace. And the next question is, do you think by design, or, as the American designer John Beelenberg puts it so brilliantly, do you think wrong? Because designers have a habit of thinking almost the wrong thing. Now, I was a trustee of the Royal College of Art in London for 10 years, and I think one of the most special things that I discovered during that period was that 25%, this is our leading grad school for design, and 25% of the students are dyslexic. Literally, their brains are wired differently, and I think that is something to actually build into a team. You get different sorts of thought processes from designers. Indeed, from New Zealand designers. And this is the work of Patrick Morris. I'm sure you know it. But I was with Patrick and his brother, Jake, again, a few weeks back. I mean, it's wrong, isn't it, to think that you can grow a plant upside down? Nobody would think that, except actually he'd looked at some of the research from NASA. He'd been thinking about these issues, and he developed the Sky Planter. And there's a project at the moment that we're incubating and part of at Thames and Hudson. And I think it's also a bit of that sort of design thinking. It's quite wrong thinking to think that actually now, just by applying a European design sensibility to the Chinese language, that you could find a new way to teach Chinese. But actually, that's what Shaolan Zai has created. It's a really bold idea. She's a serial entrepreneur herself. She's teamed up with a European designer, actually an Israeli designer, Noma Bar, who works in the UK. Let me just show you what they're doing. I think this could be massive. It's certainly a big idea. 1.7 billion people on the planet speak Chinese, and yet it's one of the hardest languages to master. It's incredibly relevant, of course. And what she's saying is, we can break down the barriers of the Great Wall of Chinese language. And she was the daughter of a calligrapher. She really understands the meaning of the Chinese pictograms. And she believes that by applying a design approach, you can make the Chinese language accessible. She's broken it down into 200 key pictograms. So here, I'll just show you a few of them. So here is the symbol for a person. You get it quickly. So two is to follow. Three makes a group. I'll show you, I haven't got time, I can see, to do many of these. But here's the symbol for a flame. So you put two flames together, you get burning hot. This is the symbol for a woman. Apparently, two women together makes an argument. And if you have three women together, apparently it's adultery, because any man with three women is cheating on someone. But the point is that we gain power from our significance in the market. And that's expressed as a legacy. In the future is through is in our prophecy. And the two key design questions: do you think by design, and do you design the future? And finally, respect. And we gain respect from our competence, from our ability to do things. And I think the key question here, and we've heard a little bit about this already, is do you learn by design? Great design comes from observation before innovation. Designing not just in the studio, but actually designing in the field. Now, this is a project that I instigated when I was at the Design Council, and I think it really illustrates this point about using observation, actually learning from what you're already doing and seeing where the improvements can be made. And actually, that can be the source of huge disruptive thinking. And in this case, we were looking at infection control with the NHS. It's one of the big issues globally. Cost, you know, going into a hospital, catching MRSA or C. difficile, it costs our health systems billions of pounds, and it's a huge human cost as well. So designers and ethnographers, we sent in to have a look at what was going on in hospitals, work with the clinicians, workshop with them, and also just spend time observing actually what's going on, you know, at grassroots with the nurses. These are some of the examples that came out. I mean, the key insight was that hospitals need to be easy to clean and easy to keep clean. Here on the left was before, which is a standard cabinet in a hospital with made of chipboard, lots of nooks and crannies. On the right, a redesigned cabinet. It's really easy to clean. It's made of really the latest materials, anti-static. You can lock your drawer, but actually there's no key because that's all through an RFID tag. It comes in on price. I'll show you another one. Here, you've got the commode. The team identified that most commodes have up to 100 working parts. That's loads of places for bugs to lurk. On the right-hand side, you've got a redesigned commode. Here, back to that point of finding new combinations of people, this was the team that designed the sleep seat for another aircraft carrier, I won't say who. And they teamed up with a manufacturer. They'd never worked in this area before, and they designed a new commode, which has become the standard commode. It's stackable, it's easy to clean, it can go in a sluice room. It won the Ergonomic Society Award, but also, you know, back to that point about emotional ergonomics, it looks much more dignified as well. Here, nurses in the east of England identified that mattresses, when punctured, can pass on C. difficile. That one insight led to a really disruptive, innovative idea, because they picked up that the often damage to a mattress doesn't get detected. So they said, OK, let's put a layer of hydrochromic ink under the first layer, so that if any human waste goes in, then actually the hydrochromic ink will change color and we'll be able to see there's damage and we can get rid of it. Really clever, a simple idea coming from observation, and actually, of course, that's a radical innovation. And the businesses that pick up these ideas then, of course, can grow. And in this case, just from this one set of products, and there's a whole load more of them, there were, within 2 years, £25 million of sales, and the sales have gone absolutely exponentially for the businesses involved exporting around the world. And the final question is, are you in the design race? And I know for business people, often this is one of the hardest ones, I think, to wrestle with, is actually the psychology and the mentality of designers that you want to work with on an ongoing basis, and really understanding their mentality and how they think. And designers are motivated by wanting to make the world better. And that's actually a quest in its own right. And of course, also, they want to be well regarded by their peers as well. So they are part of a design race, and actually, as business people, we can tap into their motivations as well. We were very involved at the Design Council in the whole of the design of the Olympics, and we were very aware of that. As we set up the competitions and the design reviews on those projects. And actually, out of those competitions came all sorts of really interesting innovations. I haven't got time to go through them today. At Thames and Hudson, where I've been leading innovation and strategy and change over the last 18 months, we have to bring out 180 very high quality, high value added books. It's on visual culture, it's on design, it's Hockney, it's the Rolling Stones. We'll work with up to 40 different designers at any time around the world. Some of the best designers, and also designers that are working in-house for us. And of course, we have to both give them the space to think and be creative, as well as also challenge them, and they are in themselves challenged by their peers. This is an image from Adrian van Hooydonk, who's the head of design at BMW. So he set a challenge to look at the whole issue of layering with his design teams, four design teams that he has working around the world, both collaborating, but also very much in the right way competing with each other, because ultimately you don't get to stay on the team unless you are succeeding in bringing forward ideas and your ideas are getting through to concepts and ultimately into manufacture. Here, the layering in the wood turned into the dashboard of the BMW. The same goes for BMW, where you've got a wonderful sparring between the heads of design at Jaguar and Land Rover, and they're both on the board of Jaguar Land Rover, which is so important, and it works phenomenally well for them. That sense of putting the space, that what sometimes people call the slack, for the designers to operate, but also the competitive environment as well. Here, Bjørke Ingels, the Danish designer, who has just won an international competition to create the world's first incinerator power plant. It's absolutely extraordinary. Here you've got Copenhagen will be but literally burning its trash to generate its energy. But what Bjørke suggested, which they are creating, this is one of Europe's flattest countries, is their first ski slope. How disruptive is that? And finally, I mean, I used to run an organization called DNAD, which was a sort of Oscars of design, is a sort of Oscars of design. And in 2013, this was the most awarded design group. This is one of their identities. The company's called Bibliotech. And this is an identity they did for Covent Garden, the whole area, which is going through big regeneration at the moment. But they are motivated by just doing great work, doing great design, and being really admired for that creativity. And that in itself is something that businesses can tap into. It's a motivation. And just as we need to understand the motivations of our consumers, we need to understand the motivation of our designers. So in wrapping up, I think we need to be, and we want to be, and it's important that we're loved by our consumers. We gain that from our identity. I think there are two key questions we need to ask. Are you a co-creator, and does design tell your story? We gain power from our significance and our relevance in the market. Are we thinking by design or thinking wrong? And do you design the future? And finally, we gain respect from our consumers because of our core competence, our ability to deliver the products and services in the market day in, day out, and our capacity to do that. And the question is, do you learn by design? Are you observing? But also, are you in the design race? And as my last comment, as I see on my screen, it says bye. I suppose the question is, so of these six questions, is one more important than the others? And in answering that, I'm slightly torn, because on the one hand, I think it is incredibly important that you are in the design race itself, that you are accessing design talent that's out there in New Zealand and also in the world, and also that you have great design capabilities in your business. And then the other is, do you think by design? So is design actually locked in to your leadership and your strategy? Well, ultimately, I would come down in favor of the first, because ultimately all the rest follows. So design in leadership, do you think by design, is probably, I believe, the most important of all. Thank you.